Father is devoted to teaching us the glory of the ages and all that He has and all that He possesses every second of the day. He's really, well, yeah, that's the typical Christian response. Not one at all. Why? Because it just, we don't live in that realm. But I'm telling you tonight, I pray in Jesus' name, you'll start living in that realm. Yes. You guys see, your seconds can be more about you making money and doing your job and living for you and having a, for the most part, you know, 95% of your time and interaction with people is purely on a human level. And God will make you, give you a transition so that you begin to be a representative of the kingdom 100% of the time. Hallelujah. And that's why I believe that you're going to see and hear and understand things tonight that's going to help you to be able to do that. See, if I were just to talk to you about these things, and it would just be this lofty, wonderful, glorious thing that, you know, one or two people are allowed to walk into. And you just get to be happy that you're in the family. That's the way it was back in the days of the Old Testament. Aaron and Moses got to go in. Joshua got to stand right outside the door, and everybody else was way off looking on. Huh? And they would come out, and everybody knew, man, they were doing something was going on in there because of the glory and the fire of God all around that tabernacle. And then they could come back and talk about the splendor of it, and nobody else would ever really be able to engage in it. Father has made a way where every one of us get to come stand in that place and beyond. Because now He's made a way where we can come and behold Him. Oh, with an unveiled face, face to face. Now He's made a way to where that it just isn't just on the external of that which the senses of men can behold. And then you got to try to figure out what that means. How good are you at that? Not very good. The best of us are not good. Or I could say the best of them. They're not good at it. Hallelujah. The best perceptive minds on the planet are not good at that. But God, the Holy Ghost, has come to live on the inside of us. God came to live on the inside of us. Something's going to happen to you tonight, Ruth.
Yes.
Let me tell you what's going to happen to you tonight.
Hallelujah.
Let me tell you what's going to happen to you tonight. The authority of God that is in your life is going to begin to be unveiled.
Yes.
You know what? That's for people who cry out day and night. There are people who cry out day and night. There are people who are so desperate for God, nothing else can even satisfy them. Hallelujah. And those people are able to hear what God has to say. Everybody else is playing imagination. It's like homogenation. They're imaginated. Oh, Robocos, but it's happening. I'm telling you right now. This is a select audience in the front row here tonight. Of people who are going to do mighty things in the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Because you're not willing to do anything in this world. Because you want nothing in this world.
Amen.
Because you want nothing in this world. Nothing is valuable in this world to you.
Amen.
Thus, habaketekaya. Because all you're passing, because you have no value, you have no meaning in this life.
Amen.
Your value and your meaning is in the realms of this life in Christ Jesus. I'm gonna speak some things to you tonight, by the Spirit of the Living God. Hallelujah. And if you will listen, and then if you will do it, and if you will obey God. I was listening to someone talking about P.C. Nelson. Probably many of you don't even know who P.C. Nelson was. He's the guy that said, if we send our kids to secular school, they're going to strip them of their power and insight in God. And so he started Southwestern University. He was the champion for the Assemblies of God right after the Assemblies of God formed early on, around 1916. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He left a great legacy. Why? Because he said, I'm going to be a champion. He could have done anything he wanted to do. He's a brilliant man. He could have done anything he wanted to do. What happened was he had an encounter with God. He said, I want God.
Amen.
See what happens. We go looking around and somebody says, you can be the president, you can be the king, you can be a lawyer, you can be a doctor, you can be anything, you can be a billionaire, you could be a millionaire, you could have this, you can have that, shiny cars, here's another house, this and that and the other thing. And then there's God over here. Some people looked and said, ooh, I'll take him. I don't, but you're going to have to lose all this other stuff. No, I will. Can I have him and some other stuff? And then we got doctrines for that. Well, they didn't have those doctrines formulated yet then. That was pre-formulated of those doctrines. He was telling about one time how he was watching Alexander Dowie, who was another guy, could have done anything he wanted to do. Brilliant guy who had an encounter with God. And there was this woman who had a cancer going outside of her head. It was as big as her head. The cancer going out of her head was as big as her head, and it was growing into her mouth. And it was starting to choke her. Can you imagine that? There's a big old cancer out here. You can't direct the cancer. They can't touch it, right? Now it's growing in. It's out here. Are you with me? It's as big as her head, and it's growing into her mouth. Are you with me? Is that affliction or torment or what? You know what Alexander Dowie did? He walked up and peeled it off. There were doctors present. T.C. Nelson was present. They all went up and looked at a brand new baby skin where he peeled it off, just walked up and peeled it off. Hallelujah. You know what that's called? It's called authority. Yes. And I'm going to tell you something. Listen to me. So many of these guys didn't have all their doctrines right, but they had one doctrine right. Here's the one doctrine that they had right. I'm in God and he's in me. Amen. That's where they got one doctrine right. I belong 100% to him, and everything about me he loves. One doctrine right. They moved out of condemnation and shame and fear and always trying to figure it out, and one day trying to be like God. These are the only people that had ever come into the authority. Everybody else has been left outside. It's not like God has just given the authority to just a few people. It's just only a few people are willing to embrace what the Lord said and say, it's mine. He's in me and I'm in him. I'm thinking about that. That's what I'm talking to you about tonight. I'm going to talk to you about breaking paths and breaking through things. When you know you have an authority. I mean, just think about it. Somebody makes you a traffic cop tomorrow. And you're just standing there on the sidewalk and you're afraid to walk out there in the middle of the street and start telling people to stop. And you got your hand up and they're still coming a little too fast than what you think they should be, and you run back to the sidewalk. Guess what? You're going to get fired because you're too fearful. There's something wrong with you. Huh? Your authority doesn't work. Everybody knows about your authority, but you, except for you. You're uncertain. I'm attacking something tonight, man. I'm attacking that afflictive thing that's on the side of your head. Signs and wonders and miracle workers. Don't you even let up, Tori. Don't you even let up, Raphael. Don't you even let up, Annalyn. Don't you even let up. Every one of you, stand up here. Hallelujah. Paco Resitandala. Claire and Jacqueline. Hi, Mom Jessica. I had injured my leg in a surfing accident when I was 17 years old. I mean, it was bad. It was a bad accident. It was a terrible accident as far as my leg goes. A big wave got the better of me. And when the doctors went through and looked at the thing, they said, there's just no way. They said, you're going to have such terrible arthritis in this thing because it just tore everything. It tore the kneecap. It tore the cartilage. It tore the ligament. Somebody said, well, your collateral ligament, every one of them just smashed. Just moved my leg over to the side. And there was a period of time in my life where I mean, it was just, if I took a step, it was excruciating pain. Running from my knee up to the top of my head and down to the bottom of my foot. And you know what I said? I made up my mind. You pain, You will not dominate me. Yeah. And every day, I mean, there was a time I'd go to sleep, I'd try to go to sleep at night, and the pain was so intense. It was so intense. But there's no sleeping. Pain is too intense. Now, I was praying for people, and we were getting wonderful miracles. I was telling people, you healed right now, and they were being healed. And this went on for years, and I'm like in this pain. Well, you know what I did with the pain? I went running. And what I did with the pain, I jumped. Come down on the pain, and it's like, ah, in Jesus' name, huh? I have no pain. No pain. My leg still looks a little off, but that's okay. Because the reality of it is it's not even supposed to be able to work. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to go to the total extremes with you tonight. I want to go from the place of peeling, just having such authority. You know, friends of mine were with T.L. Osborne and with Bensonita Hosa, and they were men. The authority was unveiled to them. And they knew that whatever they said would happen. They command the wind and the waves. You know, here you can hear about Alexander Dowie. I think he made 18 trips across the ocean during that days, or it was maybe late 1800s. And they didn't have navigation devices, you know, to go around storms. He just commanded the storms, and they dissipated. Amen. But before many witnesses, that's why he had such a huge following. That's why he started a host city, Zion, Illinois.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Because there was authority there. And God revealed such authority like that in people like Bensonita Hosa and others that just suddenly stepped into their it. They became it. They become the ones in charge now reigning in this life. And I'm going to show you how Paul saw himself as it. And there was no compromise. There was no compromise. They were not involved with other things. They were not conflicted. They were it. They were it. They were fully vested with all the fullness of God and the authority of God. Very few people have been willing to go that far with God. Everybody else is sitting back, all crowded, you know, together and trying to make each other kind of feel good about their bad behavior or whatever, or their defiled conscience. Trying to figure out when God's going to love them one day. Well, God wants you and I to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge. And he that dwells in love dwells in God. To know and believe the love that God has for us, God is love. He that dwells in love, hallelujah, dwells in God. To know and believe the love that God has for us, for God is love, herein is our love made perfect, that in the day of boldness, that in the day of judgment we may have boldness. Just think about that. In the day of judgment, when all heaven and earth flees away from him, I'm standing there going, nah, you listen, I'm telling you, you're not going to have that unless you hunger and thirsting for it. And that you let God unveil these things to you. And it's not going to happen unless you leave everything behind. Forsake it all for the sake of the call.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You're going to have to quit being compromised.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You know, I think that's one of the things they say in war. They say, well, that unit's compromised. Bring them in. They can no longer be effective. They're compromised. Their mission is compromised. They cannot be effective anymore. We want you to. We're going to have communion in light of this here tonight.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. First person you're going to have to get bold with is you.
Amen.
You're going to have to start telling yourself what you're going to do, how you're going to act, what you're going to believe, how it's going to go down. I went home and I was listening. I was listening. On the news for just a few minutes, I didn't listen long, but there was this girl on there with type 1 diabetes. And as soon as I heard it, I got so angry. I just got so angry. I was so angry inside that we allowed disease to remain on the earth. I'm just so angry about it. The only people getting any kind of credit, some doctors, some man system. Tell you right now, I'm not going to die like that. I'm not going to die. I'm not going to die by the help and the grace of the God. I'm not going to die leaving the church so powerless and helpless. Just a couple of people. Come on, man. I'll tell you right now. I pray in Jesus' name, every one of you get so big tonight, you grow 40 foot tall.
Amen.
grow 40 foot tall and die. Are there going to be troops that are going to come out against you of hindrance and defiance against the things of God? Yeah, but you can run through the troop. Are there going to be walls of hindrance, as it were, and separation try to build up against you so you can't get in? Yeah, but you'll leap over the walls. Hallelujah. We used to sing a song when I was little. So high, can't get over it. So low, can't get under it. So broad, can't get around it. You must go through the door. Christ Jesus. Remember that song? No, I'm the only one. I walked in the door. I'm in the kingdom. I'm not walking back outside wondering. Come on now. Come on now. Come on now. Hallelujah. One brother, he's so hungry for the Holy Ghost, he's once so hungry for the things of the Spirit. He had heard about the outpouring of the Holy Ghost. And of course, this is when revival is just happening and the power of God is being made manifest to a lot of different people's lives. And you know, he wanted to start moving in things. He's a Baptist preacher. And they said, and a dear woman of God came to him, who's leading the Terry meetings, which is what they used to believe that you had to do, come at Terry meetings. And Terry meetings are good until you baptize in the Holy Ghost. I mean, some people got something that is not really real. I want the real. I know the difference. I know the difference between the real and just some substitute. Yeah. And you know, when you've been around it, you know, it's like they say, how do you learn how to handle counterfeit money? By handling real money. You know, you just know, and you can feel it, if it's counterfeit or not. But anyway, the minister said, you have to give up everything. If you want these things, the only thing that's holding you back is that your heart's not right. You're not willing to give up everything. The only reason you're not stepping in is because your heart's not right. You got to be tonight willing to give up everything. And he thought, well, my goodness, I'm a significant pastor in my denomination. And if what we're talking about is that I'm willing to give up my church, my paycheck, my reputation, my position. He said, and he walked out and said, I'm not willing to do that. He got in an automobile accident not too long after that. He was terribly injured. The person who was leading him into the things that the Holy Ghost came and prayed for him immediately got healed. He resigned from his church and from his paycheck. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But there's also been people that have had that happen to them and they just went on being stubborn and stupid. Huh? Those are synonyms. Mean the same thing, you know, but are spelled differently, right? You can be seated. You know, I love to just worship. I love to worship, but I want to see you worship. I want to see you worship more intense. You don't worship good enough for me. You guys aren't passionate enough for me. It's a real letdown watching you worship lots of times. That's right. You need to get more passionate. I mean, it wouldn't even be right to number you in the company of the seraphim. Amen. They'd blow you away. Hey, come up here. Come sit up here. I want to look at you. Some people I just want to look at. I'm just bandekeres. There's some people I just really believe are ready for something greater in God. I just believe it. You're not compromised. See, that Baptist preacher is still deciding whether or not he was going to leave everything. I'm finding people and getting them on the front row who I see in the spirit, they've left everything. They will leave everything. They'll do whatever it takes to walk with God. Think about it. Alexander Downey. Think about Alexander Downey. He was a brilliant lawyer. He was a brilliant lawyer. Successful lawyer. He had an encounter with God. That's all it took. He didn't sit around and spend the next 5, 10, 15, 20 years deciding what he was going to do. He left everything. Same thing happened with John G. Lake. He was a successful businessman, worth more than $1 million at that time, back in the early 1900s. That would be like, you know, that'd be, well, I don't know, 10, 10 times more, 100 times more now. He had an encounter with the Lord. He left everything. He said, forget about it. He gave it all away. Got a one-way ticket to the mission field. That's what he did. And then people wonder, well, how is it that he stepped into such authority? What's wrong with me? What's wrong with me is that we're not willing to go all the way. And I want you tonight to understand it's really about going all the way with the so great a salvation that he's given you. And quit making yourself something other than him. Because everybody who stepped in this authority has believed that they're in God and God's in them and there ain't no separation, not a moment of it. And if there is lack, he's making up the slack, taking up the slack of the lack till he gets us straightened out. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
That if there is some lack, he's taking up the slack till he gets us straightened out. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Isn't that good?
Yes.
Hallelujah. I'm walking around in him. I'm not a self-made man. I'm a God-made man. I'm not perfected myself. I'm perfected by him. Having begun in the spirit, I'm not going to do anything on my own to make myself any better or more acceptable to grow to mature. I'm going to be perfected by the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I came here many years ago and I have not budged. And I'll just tell you right now, faithfulness is something very important to God. Hallelujah. Teki rishtandula moshikaha. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Shuta rabapa. I want you to press into God and get more passionate about loving him.
Amen.
Have let your hair down classes. Kissing Christ Jesus classes. A display of passionate emotion and thanksgiving. See, as the more you spend time with him, that veil is taken off and you begin to recognize what he did for you. And it isn't religianity anymore. It ain't religianity anymore. It's real. It's real. It's real. You don't have to wait till you're standing before him and seeing that glory and seeing the passionate display of angels, of seraphim, of cherubims, to ultimately understand how real it is. Yeah, just come on up front and interrupt everything. Okay? You guys need to get some reverence. Could have got a back seat. You do not have to wait until you pass out of this life into the next life to be able to understand how real these things are. Papa's here to show you right now. Holy Ghost is here to unveil them right now. Hallelujah. No, I'm certain. I feel certain. Clara, that you're going to, just like Alexander Dowie, walk up to those cancers and just peel them off. Like a big old sticky up there. I believe with all my heart that Jacqueline and Katie and Zoe and Raphael and Catherine and Annalyn and Annalyn's brother and Brittany and Allie and Miss Wigglebritches and Anna and Ruth Anna and Ann are going to step into the authority that's made available to everybody and start living it out.
Me too, Lord.
And I'm going to talk to you about the authority tonight, and I don't want you to back down, and don't you sit in here and criticize a single thing I say. Otherwise, there's an exit sign right there, and there's another one right there. You're not going to contaminate the place. Because when I'm simply not interested in any single person's belief in this place. I'm not interested in one comment, silent or vocal. I'm going to deliver the word of God to you, period. That's it. And if you don't believe that that's true, you better start moving now. Because we got the authority in the house. I was asking some dear friends of mine one time, I said, what is it going to take to see the pluralistic ministry that was there in the first century church once again happening in the church today? He said, people are going to have to die. I mean, everybody I've ever asked that, it's pretty much have said with one voice, people are going to have to die. There's too much arrogance Everybody thinks that they're, you know, that they have it all put together in their own mind. And a level of rebellion and defiance that goes down in the house. There's no way for you to exist in this authority being such an individual. Father has made us his very body. And I'm going to tell you right now, this is a body that is not a headless body. Jesus Christ is not a head floating around in space. Hallelujah. Going from place to place without a body. And he doesn't have a body that has no head. Hallelujah. Wherever his head is, his body's there too. Praise God.
Praise
Hallelujah.
God.
And he's here right now in this place. And I'm in him. And therefore, there is no condemnation and there is no shame and there is no sense of that I cannot do what he's commissioned me to do.
Amen.
All there is a growing in the knowledge of the love of Christ. To know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, causes you and I to step into a realm of the fullness of God, the full display of the power of God, his fullness.
Amen.
Not some of his fullness, not part of his fullness, all his fullness.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Now unto him who is able to do super abundantly above all you can think or ask, according to a power that you can pray down if you cry and scream loud enough. Come on. You're gonna say, that's right. Come on, tell me now. You're gonna have to talk. That ain't right. That's the way people do it. That ain't the way God said it. According to his power that works on the inside of us, according to this power that is in us. Hallelujah. Huh? Now unto him who, what we're talking about is all the fullness of God, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, to be filled with all the fullness of God. Now, how are we going to do that? According to this wonderful work of grace. Now unto him who is able to do all things. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Well, the one who has brought to pass all this wonderful work of grace, unto him who is able to do superabundantly above all that we can think or ask according to the power, his power, the power, the treasure hid in an earthen vessel, this treasure deposited here in my life, in your life. You're going to have to quit being on the outside trying to get on the inside. You're going to have to quit trying to be one with Christ Jesus. You'll never walk in the authority. It is a gift that has been given to us. I'm in God and God's in me.
Amen.
That's the only difference between Alexander Dowie and the rest of everyone else. Only difference between John G. Lake and everyone else. The only difference between P.E. Nelson and everyone else. The only difference between, and I can go on and on and on. But unfortunately, when you look at the measure of the total number of people from, let's just say, just over 100 years. Let's go 120 years from Alexander Dowie to Benson, Idaho. And that display of that kind of authority, the only difference is they believed they were it. Fully vested by God. They had a revelation that they were in God and God was in them. And that they had been given all authority as sons. They had received sonship authority, that they had been made heirs of God, co-inheritors with Jesus. And if there was any lack, God would make up the slack. And he would perfect everything that concerns them, so they were never on the outside trying to get on the inside. Some smear was in compromise with some kind of condemnation and lie of otherness, still trying to die. And instead of being in the faith that they are already crucified, already buried with him by baptism into his death, and raised up together with him. The truth of the resurrection. If anybody be resurrected with him, raised up together with him. Same word. Hallelujah. We seek those things which are above. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Where Christ is seated at the right hand of God.
Amen.
And to know and to believe and to begin to understand, just for example, just the pericope of Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 6, and to recognize that he is seated in a place of all power and authority, having been given a name that is above every name, having been exalted above every principality, power, and might, and dominion, and that we are in him, and that he is in us, and that we're seated together with him. You know what's the problem is that many people are still stuck back in verse 2, under the spirit of this world. In their mind, they're under the spirit of this world. Open your Bibles. I wasn't going to start there, but I want you to open your Bibles because I just want you to look at that really quick, Ephesians chapter 2. Rather than me to stand here and quote it to you, I want you to stare at it. I want you to look. Tonight, I'm crying out to for people who are willing to believe the gospel, the good news, who are willing to take a hold of the faith and recognize that you crucified with Christ and that you no longer live, you have the very life of God. You're not trying to have it. As long as you're trying to have it, you don't have it. As long as you're reaching for it, I'm telling you right now, you're not even born again yet. We've been begotten again, born again by the resurrection. It's time for us to grab a hold of the reality of who we are. She had bigger print, but she's still looking. Ephesians chapter 2. And he and you, he has made, I'm going to get rid of that. Said, and you hath he quickened. So I'm going to get rid of the King James, okay? Because I got a King James in my hand, okay? And you, he has made alive. Yes. Who were dead in your trespasses and sins. See, people still walk around with a defiled condemnation, believe that they're in trespasses and sins. It's time to get out of that mess and recognize that you've been washed in the blood. I'm getting ready to serve communion. Don't you come up here and take communion unless you know your sins have been washed away. Because otherwise you're taking communion wrong. You're not discerning the body of Christ. You're not believing his death. And when we talk about his death and when we're observing his death, we're observing the whole thing that his death resulted in, because it's not just his death at the cross, because his death, it is like didn't end there. If all Jesus did was die at the cross, then it's over. It's a religion. His death symbolizes and describes not only what happened at Calvary's cross, but what took place 3 days and three nights when he was down in the lower parts of the earth, when he lifted up his voice and he preached to the departed. He preached to the spirits in prison and commanded them. And actually, he announced with a great shout to the spirits in prison, loose your hold and let captivity captive. And then he gave us the same authority to go everywhere and deal with demon spirits. You know, I'm getting ready to go meet with pastors in Cuba for the crusade in Cuba. And the first thing I'm going to tell them is to say, listen to me. I'm not going to abide. You just going and getting all the Christians together in Cuba, because there won't be many signs and wonders if we just got a bunch of Christians in the camp. It's the truth. Everybody's been sitting around hoping for so long, it's hope deferred, heart sick. It's Nazareth. Get the lost in here. We'll have all kinds of signs and wonders and a display of the power of God. They have not resisted the Holy Ghost. Going on in their sickness, going on in their disease, going on in their sin, going on in their discouragement, going on in their disappointment. It's time somebody believe God and agree with him.
Amen.
Get up in the face of death and start laughing at it and pointing at it and saying, out of here.
Amen.
I mean, you think about it. The Lord sent you and me to go raise the dead. I mean, how many in this place, just in the past month, you've gone after raising the dead? Raise your hand. You went after raising someone for the dead? No, your dog doesn't count. Animals have nothing to do with this. Bottom line of it is, let me just say this. This is what God's commissioned us to do. He's commissioned us to go and raise the dead. That is absolutely stunning. That right there defies every logical, rational thought in the realms of human thinking. That defies every, as the Greek word is logismos. It defies every logismos. And you know what you're supposed to be doing with logismos? Of course you don't. Well, because it was translated in King James, imaginations. Every logical thinking of men, the way that men think. God wants to teach you. His words come teach us how to think different. We've received the mind of the Spirit, the mind of Christ, to do what's going on in heaven. I don't live under the laws of Newtonian physics. Hallelujah. Karisateya paha. Huh? Because I'm following my master who walks on the water. It defies Newtonian physics. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I don't live under the laws and the rules of that which the nature teaches, because God showed us how to command the wind and the waves. To have that kind of authority means that you're going to find a place in your own life where you stand up against everything that is opposed to God, and you don't allow it no more. You don't allow it in your thoughts anymore. You don't, especially don't allow it to come out your mouth. It's one thing to have things floating around in your thoughts and you're having to deal with thoughts and bring into captivity every thought, understanding how to cast down an imagination, bring into captivity every thought to the knowledge of God. Do you have the knowledge of God? This is the knowledge of God. Walk on the water, raise the dead, tell the blind to see, the deaf to hear. Come on, the crippled to walk. Listen, Jesus was absolutely disturbed and disappointed when they woke him up and said, why are you so fearful? Well, we're about to die. Why did you, he's saying, come on, get with the program. And they're just going, they're just shocked and terrified and amazement. What kind of God, man is this? Did even the wind and the waves obey his voice? When he's sleepy, he started eating and woken up. God. It's just who he is. That's who we are. We've got to work ourselves up into some kind of an anointing that doesn't even exist. Because you got to work it up. It ain't it. It's here. It's not there at all. He's with me and in me. Hallelujah. I heard somebody write this big old huge thesis. They write this big old commentary on, when you pray, should you feel God every time? And I just like, trash that book. I can give you that answer quick. Yes. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Once you learn how to run through the troop that's come out to defy the armies of God. So people, listen, it's finished. Jesus finished the work, but is it finished for you? Because the reality of it is, for many people, it's not finished. They're still in the process. You need to get into a place of where it's finished. It's finished. Where that you stepped over into a realm of not dying, but you dead.
Amen.
And buried.
Amen.
Buried with him by baptism into his death.
Amen.
That you may also be raised up together in the likeness of his resurrection.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Knowing that your old man is crucified, that you henceforth no longer serve sin anymore. Amen. But you serve God, walking in this newness of life. Even as he's walking in newness of life. Huh? People trying to die. I mean, it's as bad as trying to get a resurrection. It was a miracle that you were able to die together with Jesus. Crucified together. It's a miracle. It's just like the miracle of resurrection. You're not even born again unless you raise together with him. If you cannot confess that you are raised up together with him, you're not born again. Because this is what Peter said in 1 Peter 1:3. We have been born again by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead.
Amen.
So everybody who's still confessing, oh, I'm dying. I had a preacher say to me the other day, we were out on the road, and he says, the person you knew last year is dead. I said, no, he isn't. If I had some smart pills, I'd give you one, but I'm fresh out. He's just more mature than he was last year.
Amen.
You have to get rid of your Assemblies of God Pentecostal dying stuff. Because the fathers of the Assemblies of God didn't believe that. P.E. Nelson didn't believe that. Go back and read the fathers of the Assemblies of God, what they said when they were moving in revival. Praise God. I'm not saying they had everything right, but I'm telling you right now, they had resurrection right. They had death, burial, and resurrection right. Praise God. Hallelujah. The fundamental doctrines of, for example, Assembly of God Church was written out by P.E. Nelson. Written out, really, and a lot of them were just carried over from A.B. Simpson, others. Because, I mean, you know what? There is no new revelation. We just get to build on the revelation that's there. Amen. I mean, I was so blessed to be raised around Dake, you know, but hey, you know, and but I know where Dake got a lot of his stuff from. Got from Larkin. I know where Larkin got a lot of his stuff from. I keep on going back, and it's just all camped around the Word of God. Hallelujah. And we want you to grab a hold of the same revelation too, because it's as fresh in every generation as it was the first time it was ever given.
Amen.
These things of the Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I mean, that's something to get excited about. You don't have to wait till you die and stand before his glory. I understand how beautiful and wonderful this is. You can get passionate now. Start worshiping. Get excited about having been accepted in the beloved. Having been accepted. See this. When you know and believe the love that God has for you. Of course, I'm quoting 1 John chapter 4 right now. But when you know the love, and you know and you believe the love that God has for you, then you're over there. And what's happening in Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 18 and 19 is being fulfilled in you, where you're able to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge. Knowing the love of Christ that passes knowledge is the same as knowing and believing the love that God has for you. And herein is your love made perfect. That even in the day of judgment, you may have boldness. For as he is, so are we. I want you to grab this tonight. Yes. You. I want you to quit allowing Satan jerk you around.
Amen.
Powers of darkness, whatever new doctrine that the devils are espousing, you're propagating through your mouth. Complaint, huh? Worry, fear, concern. Listen, God wants the love to flow through you by the Holy Ghost that will cast out every kind of fear and complaint and murmuring.
Amen.
And doubt, unbelief. God has called us to come and trust him wholly. It's where Adam failed. It's where Abraham succeeded. It's what Jesus finalized for us and then made and turned it into a miracle realm called faith. Come on now. Let me tell you what every man of God who said anything in commentary of this, who's moved in power and signs and wonders, has said over the centuries. When you move out of condemnation and shame, you'll move into the miracles, the signs and wonders, and the greater works.
Amen.
And Satan is a master of his craft to keep people constantly stirred in condemnation and shame, trying to die, trying to get rid of the old man, trying to get flesh, the flesh, F-L-E-S-H, flesh man. You know, I'm a F-L-E-S-H man. It's like saying I'm an ape man, A-P-E, ape man. Give me a break. That is a defiance against what God has done for us. We're in him. He's in us.
Amen.
No, you're not supposed to allow anything of the former conversation to have any impact in your life.
Amen.
Yes, in every way, everything that belongs to the works of the flesh has been crucified. It's to be crucified. They that have crucified the flesh.
Amen.
Huh? When did that happen? Is that some second work of grace, or maybe it's a fifth work of grace by now? Huh? It happened when you were crucified with Christ.
Amen.
There is no redemption beyond what Christ Jesus did for us at Calvary. Having begun in the Spirit, are you now made perfect by your own human ability? There's no such thing. We made perfect by the Holy Ghost. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Hallelujah. You just need to start rejoicing.
Amen.
Because I'm telling you right now, Satan, the powers of darkness, the spirit of this world, will make something different and other out of you than what God has declared you to be and what he's made you to be for the rest of your life until you shut it down.
Amen.
God's given you the authority to shut it down. He's never commanded you to do anything that he's not empowered you with the ability to do it. The next time I say, when's the last time any of you raised their money from the dead in the last 30 days? I mean, I would like to see more of a representative population of the Church of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Who's going about doing what God said to do. Well, I'm just afraid to go in there. It's spooky in there. They've been embalmed. Embalming ain't going to stop any miracle. Well, then do it. Then do it. Don't just say yes or no. Do it. Get to doing it. It is not right to give a verbal affirmation when there is not the consecration of the heart to go and make it happen, to go bust down doors to see it happen. You got to quit diddle-dallying around. And step over into an authority that now moves with God's word. Instead of sitting around, you know, my dear friend, Sudeep, love you, man, in Nepal. He's in Norway right now. He said, I'm not having Bible school no more in Nepal. I said, well, what's wrong, Sudeep? Go ahead, debrief. Tell me. He said, man, we'll get people come in and they're moving in the spirit of God. They're moving in signs and wonders and miracles. They all fired up. They come in here and after a year sitting in Bible school, they're sitting around thinking, trying to figure out what God was thinking when he wasn't thinking. What God did when it was in some of the dateless past or something he never said anything about. And they've forgotten about signs and wonders and miracles and the preaching of the gospel. The fire of God's no longer in their belly. They're just all in their head. I'm done with it. I said, well, I agree with that, man. I'm doing 3 months only. 3 month training, biblical training. You can come back once a year for 3 month biblical training. It's for the rest of your life. But no more long extended stay where all you do is get in your head and sit around and talk about what God did when he wasn't doing anything. Get with the program. And if you will, God will stir up on the inside of you an unwillingness to leave somebody in the state of blindness. And if you lay hands on them and you pray that they see and they don't see, it will produce within you an agony before His presence, a desperate plea and cry to understand how to begin to move now in the authority that God has given, how to rise up and fasitalamasotaraya. I was telling a guy the other day, a preacher was complaining to me the other day. I said, well, why don't you just do what A.A. Allen did? Lock yourself in the closet for 40 days. That's basically what he did. He just locked himself in the closet and said, I'm going to stay in here until I break through. Huh? Because I'll tell you right now, as you start getting hungry for the things of God, you won't be able to live without them. See, you're not hungry for what you cannot live without. You only hungry for what you cannot live without, brother. You only thirsty for those things that you cannot live without. You drink water because you cannot live without it. You eat food because you cannot live without it. And the Lord has described our life, anyone who believes. He describes anyone who believes. People say, I'm a believer. Oh, then anyone who believes, you'll do these works and greater works than this.
Amen.
These signs shall follow them that believe. This is the clarity of them that believe. In my name you'll cast out devils.
Amen.
You speak with the Nabasir Hitana Mahakim. Lepravatai. The declarations of heaven coming forth from your belly. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You take up serpent. If you drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt you. You lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Woo! Hallelujah. And the church, the body of Christ, makes a difference in this. I mean, when you've got a group of people who are willing, I mean, I know that some of you guys, you went and laid hands on a preacher in the hospital. You got touched by the power of God. You just keep doing that. Many of you have gone out in the streets. You saw people saved on the streets over the past couple of days. You keep doing that, and the fire of God and the glory of God begins to grow in your life. It does. Not because that now He's given you something that you didn't have before. No, you participating with what He's made resident in your life.
Yes.
I mean, we baptized in the Holy Ghost for one reason, to be endued with power from on high, to go everywhere and represent Christ Jesus in Jerusalem and Judea, in our hometown and in nearby communities and in nearby state and the uttermost parts of the world. And to do it in a particular kind of way, because the gospel of the kingdom is a gospel of power. It's a demonstration of power. Listen, Jesus said, if I cast out devils by the Holy Ghost, then the kingdom of God is come unto you. Hey, Missy, come over here. Then the kingdom of God has come to you. And He went everywhere preaching the gospel of the kingdom, healing all manner of sickness and disease. Huh? We know how that God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power, who went about doing good. And He said He wants us to go about doing good too. These works and greater works. And this is, so people, there's people who are willing to, they're just willing to let their life, they're just happy to be on the worship team. Jesus didn't even have a worship team. Are you listening to me? Get busy. Quit pretending. Get after the program. It's fun. You see people around you, you sick, come over here right now. I'm going to pray for you. Go get healed.
Amen.
And they don't come towards you. Just you go walking towards them. If they start running, you chase them down. Hallelujah. I'm telling you right now, God made us in charge and we act like we've been discharged. Are you listening to me? God made us the head and we act like the tail more often than not. Come on now, it's true. One day, this nation is in peril, and only the church can turn it.
Amen.
It's boiling over on the socialist, it was just progressive liberals, now it's liberal socialists, next it's going to be socialist communists. And they're going to get all upset when Bernie doesn't get the nomination from the Democratic side and goes to Hillary. And this is going to be rights in the street. It's going to be more. I told people, I was sitting with a preacher, and I said, listen, what's going to happen? It's because of what's going on with Trump and his bandwagon and all this nonsense that's going on, because we want to exalt the vilest men to rule over us. See, you look in the Old Testament, you say, how could God's people want to exalt the vilest men to rule over them? Same way we're doing it. Because we're deceived.
Yeah.
I say, you watch what's going to happen. There's creating so much strife and dissent. There is going to be riots in these meetings. Right after I said it, within an hour, he went to television and he saw there was riots.
Yeah.
This is the beginning. It's boiling over.
Yeah.
This nation has never been so polarized. And the church has never been so silent and so powerless. Yeah. And you and I are going to do something about that.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
We're going to do something about that.
Yes. Amen.
Because you're in charge. You don't grow up to be in charge. You're in charge.
Amen.
Huh? Right. Under the law, you had to grow up. You were like a child, differ nothing from nothing more than a servant, though you were heir of everything. But we're under tutors and governors until the appointed time. But now we've received sonship as heirs of God. Just stepped right into it. The day you were born of the resurrection, born of the word, the incorruptible seed that lives and abides forever, born of the spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus. Matushina mahapa. Li romangina mahaishi. Mona mendaina shipa. Limrivaki di sheep. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the Lord. Tala sikene mishtifi. Arremana. Yes, itala. Just sit there for just a minute. Let me rest my arm. I'll come back and get you for another ride here. And he has made you alive together with him. Alive together with him. That's what resurrection's about. People want to celebrate the resurrection, and it hasn't become relevant to them. They want to talk about what Jesus did. Praise God, he did it. But is it relevant to you? You've got to do it with him. You've got to be raised up together with him. People talk about a substitutionary crucifixion. There is no such thing. It's no vicarious offering. He didn't expiate some kind of superstitious thing for us. A miracle took place and we were crucified together with him and raised up together with him and are alive together with him and seated together with him. Hallelujah. This ain't no substitute nowhere. No vicarious offering nowhere. Doesn't exist from Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21. It's the philosophies and ideologies of men. And those words have left us stripped of power and authority, because I'm going to tell you right now, only agreeing with God's word will result in the life that he has pronounced, the miracles that he demands. And Father, by according to his mighty power, has given us everything that we need to life for life and godliness. And when you preach like this, I mean, people, the exit doors are quite often used. It's true. It's true, because reality of it is that God, the Holy Ghost, will not tolerate anybody interrupting me. Why? Because I'm preaching his word. Hallelujah. 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 And it won't be long. It won't be long. You watch what's going to happen. You watch what Father's going to do. Papa is going to come and he's going to glorify his only begotten son. And his word is going to be heard throughout all the land. It's everywhere. God's not going to just have a few in these last days, but a great and mighty army.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
With doing great exploits.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
With healing in their wings. Pasuromanaya. Who run and are not weary. Who walk and not faint. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Woo. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Wherein in times past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince and the power of the air, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience. But you not that anymore. And now Satan tries to come, try to put that stuff on you, try to claim that that's where you are, but that's not who you are. Among whom you also had your lifestyle in times past after the lust of the flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But God, who is rich in mercy for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath made us alive together with Christ. I'm alive together with Christ. By grace, I have been washed with the water of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. That's what you got to do every time you see the word saved. You have to put its equivalence in there as Paul delivered it in Titus 3:5. Washed with water of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Ghost, because that's what it means to be saved. I am saved. I'm not being saved. That is nonsense. That belongs to Tischendorf's text. It does not belong to that which we received. It's not the received text. We saved. It is a done deal. I'm not becoming a new creation. I am a new creature. I'm not becoming that one who is born of God. I've been born of God. I'm not becoming someone that is a habitation for the Holy Ghost. I am the temple of the Holy Ghost. I belong to the people of God. God's people are righteous, the world unrighteous. God's people light, the world darkness.
Amen.
God's people are Christ,
Amen.
The world Belial. Knowing that we are His temple, as the Scripture has said, He will live in us and walk in us. Hallelujah. Haha. Bravaka. Authority.
Yeah.
Authority. To really believe what Jesus said in John chapter 17, beginning in verse 21. To believe it. But I'm going to read this verse 6 because I got us all the way up here. And has raised us up together. Whew. Hallelujah. We resurrected up together with Him. If you then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your affections on things above, not on things of this earth. And Christ, who is our life, when He appears, then we shall also appear with Him in glory.
Amen.
Somebody said, well, I don't see that there. Oh, I just quoted Colossians 1, chapter 3, verses 1 through 3 for you quickly. Now we're back over here. And we're raised up together with Him. Hallelujah. And then and He's made us sit together with Him in the heavenlies in Christ Jesus. Well, where is Jesus seated? Far above all principalities and powers and might and every name that is named. God has given Him all authority in heaven and earth. And He's looking for somebody to agree with Him. And He said, in that authority, He sent us with His authority as sons, as heirs of God and co-inheritors. See, what happens is there's nothing that all of these liberal, progressive, socialist theologians can do about it. So what they do then is they take the Word of God and they twist it to their own destruction and try to destroy you with all their wild-eyed interpretations and make all of this positional to where that it's not an experience. They make it something other than the reality that God has declared it is and made it America for it to be, where He lives on the inside of you and me, and we live and dwell and exist in Him.
Hallelujah.
Outside of Him, we not alive. We don't even exist. I'm dead. I'm crucified. I'm buried 3 days, 3 nights, as it were. Totally dead, proven dead, and raised up. You don't even get to, you got to die before you get a resurrection. Everybody's trying to die. They're still dying. And their theology is that they're dying. And so I'm still being crucified. You not raised up yet. Because you got to die before you can get a resurrection. And the new birth is centered around the resurrection,
Amen.
Not at the cross. The new birth is not at the cross. The new birth is at the resurrection. That's what God says. That's what His Word says. And I am exactly right. That's right. I'm His spokesman declaring what His Word says. You go ahead and you search it out. You do your homework. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You have to slap down defiance. You have to slap down arrogance. You have to slap down pride and opposition and resistance in your own life. When it comes at you, comes at your body with some kind of affliction, some kind of sickness. Come at your mind, your thinking, with some kind of lie, some kind of slander against the new creation that God produced on the inside of you, somehow discrediting the work of salvation, discrediting the miracle, the divine grace, discrediting God's love and faithfulness. You got to learn how to slap it down.
Yes, amen.
You got to learn how to preach. If there's anything that's got to happen in this day and time, somebody is going to, besides me, is going to have to break out of the stronghold of secular humanism.
Amen.
And quit telling people whatever it is their Laodicean nature wants to hear.
Amen.
Their people-pleasing thought life wants to hear. And start declaring the Word of God faithfully with authority.
Amen.
With all authority. There is great encouragement and comfort there, but there, first of all, you're going to have to get corrected. I mean, because I'm telling you right now, when you're solving the problem wrong, when you're doing it wrong, somebody's got to tell you, stop doing it that way. That is wrong. That's not the way God ordained it. Stop it now, because you cannot bring that over here into the truth, into what Father has purposed and ordained for us to do. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. What God purposed and ordained for us to do is to believe that we dead with Him, that we buried by baptism to His death, that we are raised up together with Him, that we're alive together with Him, and that we're seated right now in the heavenly realm in Him who has all power and authority, that the eyes of your understanding would be open, that you would understand His inheritance that He has in you when He raised Jesus Christ from the dead, the exceeding greatness of His power that was extended to you and given to you when He raised Jesus from the dead and set Him at His own right hand, where He also seated you and I together with Him. Far above all principalities and powers and might and dominion. Yeah, the spirit of this world, the God of this world that works in the children of disobedience is everywhere, but I'm over top of Him.
Amen.
I'm not under Him. I'm over top. I'm above. I'm over there. I'm in over here in this place with Christ Jesus. So are you.
Amen.
And Satan tried to pull you down. They tried to cast you down. I'm in the throne room. I'm reigning right now with Jesus. I'm reigning together with Him right now because Paul was, and if he is, I am. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Somebody said, you telling me you could be baptized with the baptism he's baptized with? Yes. You telling me you could drink the cup that he drank of? Yes. God wants boldness.
Yes.
He demands it.
Amen.
So you want to get prayer for me? You want to get prayer answered? You want to get prayer answered? You want God to hear you and respond? Then let me tell you what you ought to do. Let me tell you how it's got to be done. Let me tell you a story. There was a man. It was late at night. Friends came to visit. He had nothing set before him. There was no food in the house. So he went over to his next door neighbor and he started banging. And his neighbor acted like he was sleeping. Wasn't going to get up. Said everybody, shh, quiet. Hey, I know you're in there. Hey, get up! And the guy's going, rolling his eyes, going, oh my goodness. Listen, go away! We are in bed and we're already sleeping. I said, get up! I said, get up! Will he rise because he is a friend? No. But because of his boldness, unwillingness, his importunity, his shameless boldness that will not go away until he gets what he wants. And Jesus is talking about prayer.
Amen.
And people got a false humility and have no idea what Father wants. He wants it to be a desperation, a confidence, a certainty within us.
Amen.
We want to have a false humility that says, oh God, if it be thy will. Nonsense. You're not getting any answers to that prayer because your heart's not right, because you're not asking after his word. You're not asking after the Spirit of God.
Amen.
You're not asking after truth. God is the Spirit, and you're going to have to learn how to move in the Spirit. And you're going to have to learn how to move in truth. Hallelujah. He is a living being. He's not stone and wood and clay. He's not an imagination. He's not a figment of someone's imagination. He's a living spiritual being. Hallelujah. That exists, that He is, and is here. And that's the only way that you're going to move with Him. For without faith, it is impossible to please Him. For those who come to Him must believe that He is and that He's here. And that He's a rewarder of those who keep banging. And that's why He goes, ask, seek, and knock. Because it is an expression. I hear people go off on all this pabulum of what ask, seek, and knock means. Listen, it's a Hebrew idiom that says you will not take no for an answer. You demand it. It has to happen now. Uh-oh. Somebody's got some authority now.
Amen.
Somebody believes what God said. Somebody's heir of God and co-inheritor with Jesus. Oh, we're heir of God, dear brother, and we co-inheritor with God. Amen. When we all die and get to heaven. That is, listen, give me a break. Father needs partners around right now. You know, His church is the fullness of Him that filleth all things. God wants our eyes to be open. He wants to give us a revelation and understanding of the exceeding greatness power of His power that He gave to us when He raised Jesus Christ from the dead, set Him at His own right hand in the heavenly realm, far above all principality, powers, and might, and dominion, and put gave him a name above every name, not only in this world, but also in the world to come, and made him to be the head over the church, which is right now, the church, his body, you and me, that is connected with his head, and the head and the body go everywhere together, the fullness of him that filleth everything.
Amen.
The fullness of him that filleth all things.
Amen.
And we are complete in him right now. No, we just want to try and to be saved and trying to do our part and try to make it through. It's about time. You know. Listen, I mean, it's okay. I can understand that the Lord doesn't get the brightest and the best. But he does a work of grace that gives to us his wisdom and his purity and his beauty and his splendor and his miracle power. And then that all of a sudden we transformed into the brightest of the best. I mean, he called the fishermen, you know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. Marasteke piatalaha. Mandefredeshikina bahastaloya. Man de bayafatus. Oh yeah, just wait. You know, you think it's hot right now, you're squirming right now. I'm getting ready to turn it up a couple hundred degrees.
Amen.
Centigrade. Hallelujah. Prakaradaya. Yeah, it's gonna get real hot in here in just a few minutes. And anybody who's got passengers, I'm going to tell you right now, they're going to evacuate. I pray they're going to go without the body. I pray they go without the body. Hallelujah. But one way or the other, they're going to evacuate. Hallelujah. Because I'm getting ready to do something that I have an authority of received in Christ Jesus to do. It's a little bit different than everybody else does it. It's very sacred to me. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The drinking his blood and eating his flesh. For his flesh is meat indeed. Hallelujah. And his blood is drink indeed. Hallelujah. Amen?
Amen.
And he that eats his flesh and drinks his blood dwelleth in him, dwells in him, and he dwells in them. Ooh. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. So just look with me quickly at this Matthew chapter 17. Praise God. Hallelujah. You know, it's wonderful to walk in divine provision. It's wonderful to walk in divine protection, and it's wonderful to walk in divine perfection.
Yes.
And this is what our shield and our exceeding great reward has given to us. Hallelujah.
Amen.
This is what your exceeding great reward has given to you.
Amen. Yes.
Hallelujah. And all the fear tactics of hell can take a hike. In fact, we're going to take them and we're going to bind them up and kick them out.
Amen.
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 Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Are you there in John chapter 17?
Yes.
Praise God. I'm just so excited about what God is doing in Anna's life.
Yeah.
And what God is doing in Naomi's life here tonight. I really am. Because I'm going to tell you right now, the word of God is working mightily in her right now. And I basete rabota finorona. And by the same line, Butoki, by the time she's 13, 14 years old, under the wellsprings of prophecy and the wellsprings of praise, hallelujah, that's going to be coming up out of the proclaimer here. Hallelujah. And I'm out of Anna as well. Hallelujah. Just watch and see the miracle power, the miracle working power that is in her life. I'm just so excited about what God is doing. And see, they my grandbaby, so they got to obey. Hallelujah. They don't have a choice. Praise God, we not giving them one. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody said, well, God gives us free will. Yeah, kinda. Hallelujah. He chose me.
Amen.
And I'm kept by the power of God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. And my will's in it too. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. And in that whole thing, I called upon his name, said God in desperate form, wanted to do the will of the Father. I'm telling you right now, he come got you. Then you didn't come get him. He come found you.
Yes.
And he who has begun a good work in you,
amen,
gonna finish it.
Amen.
So just go ahead and look unto the author and finisher of your faith. And go ahead and get on into this place of divine power and glory and quit trying to be what God made you. Huh? Quit trying to obtain what he gave you. Huh? Come on now in Jesus' name.
Yes.
Go ahead and embrace this so great of salvation, this unspeakable gift. Hallelujah. Go ahead. Stand up. Be it. Be the one. who gives your life to glorify the Son. Because that's what Father's dedicated to. And this is really all about the will of the Father. It's all about Father's will. And He's dedicated to glorifying His only begotten Son.
Amen.
I'm not going to stand by and watch diabetes 1 run through humanity. I'm not going to stand by and watch somebody sick in this place.
Amen.
I'm not going to stand by and watch people afflicted and tormented. If you just give you resign your will over to God and you're willing to humble yourself and obey and do what you're commanded to do, you shall eat the good of the land. Hallelujah. You shall, hallelujah, inherit all things, hey, Masata, including your health. Somebody said, well, health is a gift. Yeah, and I'm telling you right now, I know the one who gives it. Hallelujah. And if you don't feel like you've got the gift of health, we're going to get it to you. Hallelujah. But you got to cooperate. You can't be over in doubt and unbelief. Can't murmur and complain, say, where's God? You brought us out here to die. Was there not enough graves in Egypt? Moses, you make yourself something over us. We God's people too. Boy, they really got a promotion overnight, didn't they? Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Mighty woman of God. Hallelujah. Mighty woman of God. Praise the name of Jesus. John chapter 17, verse 21. Lord says that, and He says that they all may be one. As you, Father, are in me. He's not talking about that they may all be one with each other. You got no each other here. Quit adding words. That they may all be one. As you, Father, are in me, and as I am in you, that they also may be one in us. Hallelujah. Us. Not me. Us. Hallelujah. Kapate fritaya. Hallelujah. Prakashataramade. Us. 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 Not in each other. Us. Us. Can you hear me?
Yes.
I'm still talking about being seated together with Him in the heavenly realm. I'm still talking about understanding what He did when He raised Christ Jesus from the dead, gave us this exceeding great precious promises, and gave to us this great power and authority. Still talking about this place of being in Him and Him being in us and Him pouring out all the anointing that He Himself had without limits so that we could go everywhere and do what He did and is doing. That we may be His ambassadors, that we may be His co-laborers, that we may stand in His stead, that we may move forward the advancement of the kingdom of God that we have now received. The nation, He took it from the nation that had it, Israel, and He gave it to another nation that would bring forth the fruits thereof. The nation, the holy nation, a treasured people. Hallelujah. A holy priesthood, a royal nation, a royal priesthood, holy nation. That's who we are, the church, His body, His being. The church is Christ. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The very expression of Jesus in the earth, the only one. That's authority.
Amen.
We're going to get over that in just a few minutes. I'm working my way to 1 Corinthians chapter 12 in case you didn't know where I was going. And He goes on to say, that the world may believe that You sent Me. There's got to be this oneness, not a transcendent otherness, a transcendent oneness. Hallelujah. Where I've transcended out of this realm into the heavenly realm, and I live in a place called walking in the Spirit, living in the Spirit. Hallelujah. Moving in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Verse 22. Jesus says it again, in case you didn't hear Him the first time. I in them. You, Father, in me. That they may be made perfect in one. Do you see the layer? Do you see the layer? Christ Jesus is in me and the Father's in Christ Jesus. You got the layers? I got some layers here. Hallelujah. Do Do you have some layers over there? Are you going to be praying, wondering where God is from here on in? Huh? I mean, that's worse. You and I are worse off than Israel be, looking at a cloud of glory, a fire, a pillar of fire by night, and cloud by day, and the glory over the tabernacle saying, where is God? You and I are worse situation when we got these kind of layers, when we got this kind of glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. And the glory which you gave me, I gave it to them. That's the honor, that's the majesty, that's the authority. He gave to us, according to his divine power, all things that pertain to his life and to his godliness, because he called us to his glory, to express and reveal his glory and his virtue. And he said, if you'll give all attendance to making your calling and election sure, if you'll wait on these things, if you'll add to your faith, to seeing as you have the divine nature, if you'll add to your faith, seeing as you have divine nature and have escaped the corruption that's in the world through lust, if you will add to your faith, you'll add virtue into your virtue, you'll add temperance into temperance, you'll add knowledge into your knowledge, you'll add brotherly kindness into your brotherly kindness, you'll add this godliness into godliness, you'll add this divine love. And that's just saying, I'm going to give attendance to making sure that I'm yielding my members to that which God the Holy Ghost is doing instead of everything that men is doing. He said, then I will show you how to step over into the realms of divine power and glory, into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Verse 11 of the chapter. In case you don't know, I just quoted 2 Peter chapter 1 verses 3 through 11 for the most part. I got most of it. I left out a couple of verses to be quick. He wants to minister to us an entrance into this realm, how to cooperate with this divine authority, how to get into this authority that Alexander Dowie got into, that this authority that John G. Lake got into, this authority that Wigglesworth got into, this authority that Vincentitis Hossa stepped into, this authority that T.L. operated in, even though he didn't operate it in where did Vincentitis Hossa first get his ministry? Vincentitis Hossa had a church of about 20 people. His church in Africa, it was about 20 people. He interpreted for T.L. Osborne in a crusade. And in that crusade, he stepped into a greater authority than T.L. had ever had expressed in his life. He went far beyond T.L. because he saw the miracles and the signs and the wonders, and he said, I can do that. God's ordained for me to do that. Hallelujah. And that's kind of what happened to T.L. because he was watching William Branham, and he said, he turned to his wife, Daisy, and he said, God has ordained for us to do that. We're going to do that. And he wouldn't let anything discredit him or disqualify him. Huh? They'd been out on the mission field in India, him and Daisy, for many years, and they came back defeated and beaten down and discouraged because nothing got off the ground. They seemed powerless. They got into a meeting, watched signs and wonders and miracles, and decided, got a quickening, got a revelation, got an understanding, got an insight of the exceeding greatness of his power that has been given to us because of what God did when he raised Jesus up from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly realm.
Amen.
Jesus said, the glory that you've given to me, I've given it to them so that they may be one even as we are one. And look at, he's going to express it now. He's going to say it the third time, and he's going to make sure that everybody understands very clearly what he's saying. So don't go try to make up something before you hear the end of the story, because that's what people are always doing, running with a half a message and filling in the blanks. And it ain't God's message. I in them, this kind of oneness. He's not talking about you and me and you. Gross. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
Are you with me here?
Yes.
I'm not that interested in being that hooked up with you guys. I'm sorry.
Amen.
But we ought to be very interested in being hooked up with him. Being hooked up with him, we're just going to be one. Hallelujah.
Yes. Yes.
I know everybody is begotten of God because they all love me.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I love those that are begotten of God.
Amen.
Those who will not hear me, they won't hear him. Those who do not hear us, they don't hear him. Those that go out from among us, they have manifested that they're not of us. Now, if John was here today, they say, oh, that's a cult leader. Well, why don't you go read his cult? 1 John chapter 3, go read it. Go read it. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
They went out from among us that they may be man-made manifest that they're not of us. Hallelujah. There is a fellowship that I have with God's people everywhere I meet them. My first meeting, first day I met Brother Un. We had known each other all of our life. I met him as soon as he got out of prison, out of Burma, because he got put back in prison after the Heavenly Man. You read the Heavenly Man, and he got delivered supernaturally. Well, he got himself in trouble again. He went over to Burma, escaped from China, went right to Burma to go into preaching. Hallelujah. They put him in Burma. They were torturing him bad, messing him up. And Taisto went and gathered a ransom money, got him out. And right after that, I met him. It's as though I knew him all my life. I mean, I've met people in remote parts of the world. And it's as though, we walk in, baby. It's like we're family. We've known each other. Why? Because it's just, because we've begotten a God. We belong into a heavenly realm, a spiritual realm. There's a lot of people I don't have communion with. There's a wall. I don't commune with unbelief and doubt. I don't commune with strife and complaint. I have no fellowship with it. Amen. We love you, but we have no fellowship with it. I have no fellowship with it. Amen. And I know that that's the way God feels about it, and I'm not going to allow it in my life. Yes. And if there's any place where then we keep ourselves, that's what the keeping of ourselves is about, is that we're not going to have this. We're not allowing stuff in our life. It isn't going to, if I get tripped up into some kind of sin or some kind of failure, I'm going to repent, and I'm going to ask God to forgive me and wash me and cleanse me, but it's not going to change my status with God.
Amen.
Because whatever my lack is, he's going to take up my slack.
Amen.
Because I'm going to walk in the light as he's in light, and the blood of Jesus Christ is going to continually cleanse me.
Amen.
You know how many blood sacrifices and offerings went on every day in the Old Testament? Study it sometime. Just work your way through Leviticus and Numbers and try to keep track. There was a river of blood flowing. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now you and I need is the blood of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
There remaineth no more sacrifice for sin. Ooh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Oh, we have that blood of Jesus, Karato Pasika, that washes us and cleanses. If you walk in the light as he is in the light, then you have fellowship one with another. Everybody that loves me loves him. Those who don't love me don't love him. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. That's just the way it is.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Everybody who loves those that are begotten of God. I don't know about you. I know about me. I know I'm begotten of God. Hallelujah. That's what I'm saying. That's what I'm talking about me instead of talking about you. You can bring it back at me if you want. If you're bold enough. If you got a confidence enough. If you got meekness with boldness. Amen.
Amen.
If you got humility with confidence, which can only be taught by the Holy Ghost, because there's no model for it in the human realm. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Look at this. I in them, you in me, that they may be made perfect in one. See the layer? I in them, you in me. And as a result, they are made perfect in this oneness. This is oneness. This is true oneness. I'm a Pentecostal oneness right here.
Hallelujah.
See that? Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
A lot of people draw back from this. They draw back because of unbelief. They draw back because they don't look into the author and finisher of their faith. They're looking unto themselves. They don't believe in a salvation champion for them by Jesus Christ alone. They got a champion their own. They in doubt and unbelief. And it's time there be a people of God that will fully believe and be persuaded of what God did for us at Calvary's cross and what he did for us when he went down with a shout to those spirits in prison, commanding them to loose their hold, who took a hold of the keys of death and the grave. Hallelujah. Let captivity get captive and won gifts. He won gifts. I know Ephesians says that he gave gifts, but Psalm 62 says he won them and ascended up to Zion. I know it sounds like Moses, but it was Jesus. And Paul made the application. Praise God. You know what? Ann and I are going to do? We're going to live out the life we want to die and go to. In other words, we're going to live days of heaven upon the earth. In other words, we're going to walk in the Holy Ghost. In other words, we're going to live in God. Jesus invited everybody, said, come dwell in me. Hallelujah. I'm going to come dwell in him. Amen. Hallelujah. He said, if you'll dwell in me and you'll allow my words to dwell in you, you'll ask whatever you want. God, Father, will do it. In fact, this is what this Father wants, that the Son may be glorified in the Father. He still goes on and says, that the world then may know that you have sent me and that you have loved them as you have loved me. This is how the world's going to get impressed instead of depressed. Right now, because of our disobedience and because of our unwillingness to obey God and walk with God, we've made his name a byword in the midst of our captivity. But the Lord turned again the captivity of Zion, and we were as them that dreamed. Then was our mouth filled with their laughter, and our tongue was singing. Then said they among the heathen, God has done great things for them. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, man. Come on, get out yourself and get into him. Right now. Hallelujah. And then if you just look back here at a verse of scripture here in John chapter 14, just look back in John chapter 14 and verse 20. John chapter 14. And let me just start at verse 17. No, I'm just going to go ahead. It's hard for me to do this, but I'm just going to go ahead and break right on into it, okay? How do I want to do this? I want to make sure you get it. So I'll just go ahead and start at 17. Start at verse 16. Hallelujah. And I will pray that the Father shall give you another parakaletos, which is the one who pleads. The one who pleads with us. The encourager, the comforter, the mentor, the stand along. Hallelujah. The one who's come to lead us and guide us. Hallelujah. The one who's come to take everything that belongs to the Father and give it to us so that we can see all that belongs to the Father now belongs to us. Wow. That's why Jesus said, you can't get it. I got to go away so you can get it. It's expedient for you that if I go, that for me to go away. Because if I go not away, the comforter, the parakalitos cannot come. But if he comes, he's going to lead you and guide you into all truth. He'll take up everything that belongs to the Father and he shall transmit it, reveal it, disclose it to you so that you can see it and understand it and know it. Everything that belongs to the Father, everything that belongs to the Father, everything that belongs to the Father is going to reveal it, transmit it, disclose it to you. Everything that belongs to the Father. That's authority. Yeah. That's a lot of authority.
Amen.
Then all of a sudden you begin to understand Galatians chapter 4, verse 1 through 7, and realize that you're not like a child that differs nothing from a servant, though you be heir to it all, Lord of it all. But now you stepped into sonship as heir of God and co-inherited with Christ Jesus. And whatever you say, God's going to do it.
Amen.
But you stick up your hand and you command the traffic to stop. You don't have to run for the sidewalk because the traffic's still coming a little too fast for you. You stand up in front of the traffic. You say, you stand there until it slams on the brakes because you've got authority. You say to the devils, the unclean spirits, go and they must obey you. This is the gospel of the kingdom. This is what the power and the authority that the Lord Jesus gave to the 12 in Luke chapter 9 and gave to the 70 others also in Luke chapter 10 so that they go everywhere and preach the gospel of the kingdom. There's no other. Why are we going to preach another gospel? Why are we going to change his word? Why are we going to declare something else and then act like we faithfully speak his word? When he already made it very, very clear what it means to faithfully speak his word. And then after having given them such power and authority, he said, now you need to go wait and get endued with the big power, as it were. You need to go wait and get endued with power from on high when you receive the promise of the Father, because you're going to do more now. Because you're going to get ready to do more. Anyone believes you'll get ready to do more.
Yes.
Mandelika. Somebody said, well, I'm not one of the 12. No, you're the one who believes. Or you're the one who doesn't believe. Because anybody says, I'm not one of the 12, you're just opting out. You're trying to find a way to salve your own iniquity. Huh? And unbelief. Geneva, you just need to go everywhere and preach with authority.
Amen.
You just need to go everywhere. So someone, I'm waiting for doors to open up. Just kick some down. Just call some people up and say, I'm coming your way. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
There's not enough people out there preaching with authority. Huh? And I had a man of God say to me the other day, oh no, we don't have to go listen to another brilliant apologist who just knows the word so keenly, but there is no demonstration of the power and the glory of God. Please, not another one. Yeah, that's right. Because that's not the word, the kingdom of God is not in word, but in power.
Amen. Yes.
1 Corinthians chapter 4, what is that? Verse 21. Don't turn there. I'm just giving you the reference in case you thought I was just making that up. I know people are shocked because all I do is preach the word of God. All I do is quote scripture. They're shocked. They think he's got to be making some of this up. No, I'm just living in the word. You know what? Tomorrow, if you find me at 11 o'clock tomorrow morning, you're just going to be hearing the word coming out of me. If you're going to call, if you're going to come over and you want to talk about, you know, the weather, you know what? I'm just like, you talk to yourself. I'll listen. I'll try to look like I'm looking at you. If you want to talk about sports, I'm not really interested. I'm not really interested in communicating about anything other than the word. My mouth is just, it just delights in his word. I'm just not interested in talking about your troubles. Can somebody please talk with me about your troubles? Oh, I don't want to talk about your troubles. I don't want to hear your murmuring and complaining against God. I don't want to try to hook up with your doubt and unbelief. I counsel people and they start telling me about their worries and their troubles. I say, that's a lie. And then they tell me about their sorrow and upset and other concern. I say, well, that's another lie. Are we done yet? Huh? You're supposed to knock that stuff in the head.
Amen.
Your own self, so nobody else has to do it for you. But if you can't cast it down, come over and I'll help you throw it down. I'll help you deal with it. I'll help you deal with that complaining, lying stuff. Come on.
Amen.
Not even the girls talk that way. Amen. Come on. Hallelujah. I was raised around a company of a bunch of rough people, man. If you complain, you get pinged in the side of the head and told to go home. I praise God for that training. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
Come on. Woo. You got everything. You got him in you.
Yes.
And he came with Father.
Amen.
And it didn't end there. Because I'm going to show you right here. It didn't end there. You ready? Woo. I'm getting so excited about to run around the church. Hallelujah. Prasanahai. Now I will pray the Father and he shall give you another comforter that he may abide with you forever. Every once in a while. He may abide with you every once in a while. He may abide with you when you really work it up. Cry out to God, cut yourself a little bit. Agonize. Okay, good. Okay. We got that all worked out. Praise the name of Jesus. Even the spirit of truth. Hallelujah. I don't have no spirit of lie. Kandu sparataya. I got the sporeneia pifita. The spirit, the Holy Ghost, the spirit of truth. Hallelujah. I'm worshiping him, interacting with Father in spirit and in truth. I got the spirit of truth and he's leading me and guiding me into some truth. No, he's leading me, guiding me into all truth because that's all I want. I'm not interested in fame and fortune and any other compromises. I have no false motives. I'm interested in him and what he has for me. I love his abundant life, his eternal life, the God kind of life, the life of Christ Jesus, the life of the Holy Ghost been given to you, been given to me. Come on, man. Come on. And you and I are going to have to get the word in our mouth. It's going to have to become a confession. It's going to have to become a profession. You're going to have to hold fast to your confidence. Do not let your confidence slip.
Amen.
Cast not away your confidence.
Amen.
Has a great payday coming.
Yeah.
King James said it has a great recompense of reward. Hallelujah. Got a great payday coming. I'm not letting up, giving up.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. He says this. He says, even the spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive. You can't receive the Holy Ghost because you of the world. And God's got a remedy for that. Hallelujah. And it's the wonderful miracle of salvation. The only people who can't receive what the Holy Ghost has given are people who are in the world. The spirit of the world has dominance over you. And so I make sure tonight that you don't have any spirit of the world keeping you from these things of the Holy Ghost. He said, even the spirit of truth whom the world cannot receive because it sees him not, neither knows him, but you know him, I know him, for he dwells with you and shall be in you. Look at here. God, the Holy Ghost has come too. Hallelujah. And he says, and I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. Praise God. Yet a little while and the world sees me no more, but you see me. I see him. A dear man of God said he just laid hold. He'd been preaching for quite some time in Assemblies of God. And it was a wonderful man of God back in the 30s. And one day he just crying out to God, and a pastor in a small church in America, and he's crying out to God and said, Father, I just want to understand how to interact with you in the way that your word describes is available. And he just began to take a hold of crying out and praying these prayers of the Spirit. I mean, for me, I had not heard this testimony until after it was something that God also did in me. And I just started praying these prayers. I started praying the prayers of Ephesians chapter 1, verse 16 through 23. I started praying the prayers of Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 through 20. And one of the beautiful thing is what he stepped into, it, he stepped into a revelation, and he stepped into authority where Jesus came and visited him 8 times. I'm telling you right now, that stirs me up. I'm provoked. That provokes me. Huh? It's like, this is the way I feel about it. One time, Joshua and Daniel were real little, and I gave Joshua something. Daniel's standing there going, Dad, what about me? And I really didn't hear him. I was just talking to Daniel. Joshua just enjoying his response to what I was giving. Daniel's sitting over there, it's this little guy, and he's pulling on me going, Dad, what about me? What about me? What? And then he started getting a little cry in his voice. What about me? And he got my attention. That's what I'm doing to Father right now. Well, what about me? Hey! Hey, Dad! What about me? So a lot of people can live without this. I can't. You're busy, and when you live without it, you're going to get filled with a bunch of junk out there too. You can't live without it. Your heart, your mind, your affection set on this all day long. Your mind, your heart, your affection set on things above, not on things of this earth. You're not trying to do something. It's not religianity. It's a relationship, a desperate passion to know him. I must see you, God. Father, I want to see you in your glory. No one can see me and live. I don't care. I want to see you. It doesn't matter if it costs me my life. I want to see you in your glory. I want to behold you in all your fullness. That's Moses' heart. That's Exodus chapter 34. That's just the heart of the Son right there being expressed. And Father wants it, and he demands it. And he has right to.
Amen.
Because though he gives these things freely, they are not cheap. They're as sacred as they've ever been. It's sacred. It's holy. It's sacred.
Amen.
And Father understands, and he watches, and he sees, and he beholds how you handle the sacred.
Yeah.
And when you start handling sacred properly, Father will give you more. He's going to give something that is going to destroy you. Come on now. I'm talking about you and me getting over into authority. Walking in the authority that's been given, which fundamentally is realized in the is realized that you one in him, that he's in you and you're in him, that you're complete in him, that he is ahead over all things and you're complete in him. Hallelujah. That you are members of his very own being and body. Hallelujah. So let me finish reading this. He said, neither knoweth him, but you know him, and he would dwell with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. I got that. Verse 19. Yet a little while, and the world sees me no more. Okay. You see me because I live, you shall live also. Verse 20. At that day, listen to this, a very important verse of scripture. At that day, what day? The day that you receive the Holy Ghost. At that day, you shall know that I am in the Father and that you are in me and that I am in you. There are many people right now that attend churches all across America. They do not know this. They have not had that day. They do not know oneness with God. They do not know that they are in Father, that they do not know that they are in Christ Jesus and that Father and Christ Jesus is in them. They have not had that day. And this is just one of many verses of scripture that describes the same wonderful, great salvation that's been given us. And as I'm just telling you right now, I'm here to smash your doubt and unbelief. I'm here to throw a flame. I've got a flame-throwing torch to the fire of God to burn up all the chaff that's been growing in your mind and understanding. And I got a hammer. Bust up the rocks. Praise God. I want you to quit being a false prophet to yourself. People talk about false prophets. I see false prophets right, left, and center. People prophesying over their own self things that are false. It's not the word of God. That's false prophecy. God's word does not need to be proven anymore. If a person spoke and it did not come to pass, they were marked. That man was marked with the familiar spirit. Speaking false things. This word needs no proof. It's already proven to be the word of God.
Amen.
In that sense. Huh? Amen. You better speak according to this word. If you want to be right, you better speak what the word says. And now no way you're going to know what the word says unless you give yourself to reading it.
Amen.
Huh? Of course, there have been many examples of people who only knew just the first few verses of Scripture. They only had the first few verses of Scripture. They didn't have the Bible. And with their few verses of Scripture that they misquoted, they went and did great signs and wonders and miracles. And tens of thousands and even hundreds of thousands of people came into the kingdom while they misquoted the few verses of Scripture that they had. While God's people in America sit around with so much head knowledge that they could basically, it's just not even right. You know what? And can barely add a soul to the kingdom. There's something wrong with that. I would start fasting and praying if that was the description of my life. I'd get a breakthrough and say, there's something wrong. There's something wrong with that. Do you know there's something wrong with that?
Yes.
Are you willing to just leave something wrong?
No.
We're just going to leave it wrong. It's something wrong.
No.
House may burn down, but, you know. I smell electrical fire, but, you know, I don't know how to fix it anyways. We'll just sit here. Are you with me?
Yes.
Nah.
No.
Now you're going to call somebody. You're going to get somebody on the phone right away. We see smoke coming out of the receptacle. We're not sure what it is. We figure we better call somebody. Because something's definitely wrong. There's smoke coming out of the thing. And I think I saw a little fire. I saw a flash of something. It's a fire. And the wall is starting to turn a little brown. And I put my hand on it. It did seem warm. Sir, I would evacuate the house right now if I were you. We have the fire department on its way. And people live that way spiritually. There's all kinds of indication there's a serious problem. So what you do is you just say, you give yourself a response to God tonight that is a resolve to do Father's will. To walk in His way, no matter what it costs you, because you're called to lay down your life. And with that consecration, you step into the authority that's given and just start living it out, and you'll immediately have a resolve. But as long as you sit around going, I just don't know. I've tried, I prayed, and I gave Him the offering, I've been in all the meetings. I just don't know. Nothing will change. You're going to have to start, you're going to consecrate yourself, do what God said, and go and do it, and you're going to have everything that God described. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Tonight, if you do not know that the Father is in Christ Jesus, and that Christ Jesus is in you and you are in Him, the Lord wants to remedy that. He wants to give you the revelatory gift of the Holy Spirit. He wants to settle this thing. This is the spirit of wisdom and revelation. I mean, it's not in fullness because Paul's talking to a church in Ephesus who has received. The church at Ephesus had received John 14:20. But he's telling them, listen, there's more for you. There's more for you. God doesn't want every... And I can just see Paul talking to a church at Ephesus and where everybody's basically just listening to the ministry and watching the signs and the wonders and the miracles being worked as the various different traveling ministries was coming through, like Peter and John and, you know, Andrew. Everybody was there. And, you know, the other number of the 120 and the 70 others also, and, you know, Stephen and Philip. And they're just sitting there enjoying it. He's like, going away, come on now. You guys got to get to work too, because we're here about perfecting you and building you up to you so that you go and do the work of the ministry.
Amen.
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 And so that's why he says, now listen, you can't just sit there and say, look, you're just a number, one of the number in the body of Christ. You're going to have the spirit of wisdom and revelation and knowledge of him so that you recognize that the same power has been given to you so that you'll now go with the authority of heaven and start functioning as the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. And what he basically laid out in a general sense in Ephesians chapter 1, he then brought into greater detail in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. So just turn there real quickly with me. And then we're going to have communion. So you can start helping me with communion here, okay? Where did Allie Deer go? The girls had needs? We're going to get them through that. Thank you, Jesus. Now I want you to see yourself in this. If you remain silent, if you remain silent with the truth, then the lie will fill the void. If you sit around indecisive because you so want to be right, you just want to be certain it's God, you're never going to do nothing in your brain-damaged head.
It's true.
You hear what I'm telling
yes.
you?
Yes.
It's someplace you're going to have to get confidence that God's at work.
Amen.
And that he's inspiring you, praise God. Huh?
Yes.
Because as soon as the sober-minded person full of the Spirit of God is not willing to speak, then the person who's got nothing that just out there in la-la land is going to fill the void. As soon as the person who has the truth holds their tongue, the lie will fill the void. I'm going to speak. I'm not going to stop speaking. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And so, you know, Paul lays down the fact of what's going on in the midst of the church here. He says, but in the church, he says the manifestation, and I want to just kind of skip around for you a little bit so that you can understand really the whole context of what's going on. But you look in verse 7, he says the manifestation of the Holy Ghost is given to every person so that you may be brought together as one. And another King James translated it so that you may profit therewith or thereby. Okay?
Yeah.
But it literally means to be brought together as one. You know, see, God takes us, God the Holy Ghost. Whew, listen to me. God the Holy Ghost has baptized us into the very person of Jesus. The Holy Spirit, we, by one Spirit, we have all been baptized into one body. We've been baptized into the person of Christ Jesus. People don't talk about being baptized into one another. Forget about that. That is nonsense. This is all about Jesus. It's all about heaven. It's all about the Father. It's all about the Holy Ghost. God the Holy Ghost has baptized us. By one Spirit have we all been baptized into one body. And he's describing now the activity of the Holy Ghost so that no one is misunderstanding what God has purposed in terms of the gifts of the Spirit and the diversity of the Spirit and the administration of the Christ, of the Lord. He wants to make sure that people aren't going to get off into a human realm. He's going to say this very specifically. Here's what's going to be happening. There's going to be given by one the Spirit of wisdom, the other the word of knowledge, and to another by the same Spirit. He's going to give the faith, and by another to another he's going to give the gifts of healing and the multiplicity of gifts of healing. I mean, I've been with different people. Some people, they've got an incredible gift of healing for backs. They pray for anybody who's got a back pain or back injury, they get healed. They got an amazing gift of healing specifically for people who have migraine headaches, and they pray for somebody who got migraine headaches and they get healed. Another person, they specialize. They have an amazing gift of praying for people who have any kind of tumors or cysts. Immediately they disappear, they go away. It doesn't mean that you have to be limited, but you can start somewhere. And Father wants to give that to you. And it's not an exercise of human thinking. It is a place of relationship where God the Holy Ghost takes you over into a revelation realm, a cooperation realm, an entrance realm into knowing how to function and flow in the authority which God has given. Not an experiment. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
And to another, the working of miracles, and to another prophecy, and to another discerning of spirits, and to another diverse kinds of tongues and interpretation of tongues. And understanding this in the context that God has poured out his Spirit upon all flesh. Understand this in this context. See, because this is a generalized context. But now let's take the bigger generalized context. Okay, let's say this is a 15,000 foot view. Now let's go to a 30,000 foot view. 30,000 foot view is he's poured out his Spirit upon all flesh. He's poured out the Holy Ghost upon every being, every person, everyone who would receive, not just a few. And when he poured out his Spirit upon all flesh, every single person is described by both Joel, the prophet Joel, and Peter as prophesying. and in the context of other tongues. Hallelujah. For everyone. That's the 30,000 foot view. He poured out his spirit upon all flesh.
Amen.
The ministry of Jesus is to baptize in the Holy Ghost and fire, which was emphasized in Acts chapter 2 and verse 4.
Amen.
And he would get lost in the woods of semantics. Get yourself a mountaintop view for a moment. Look where you're at.
Amen.
Look where you're at. So you get lost in some kind of a detail trying to make something out of a verse of scripture that you don't understand its context and its application. So he says to us then, after describing these things, he says, but all of these work that one and the self-same Holy Ghost dividing to every man, all of these work by one and the self-same Holy Ghost dividing to every man individually as he wills. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And I'm going to tell you right now, there are many times, and you know, and I trust even this night, where I operate in all nine gifts of these. Every one of these expressions take place in one meeting. Whatever is needed. If there is no miracle needed, then obviously the Holy Ghost doesn't need to do miracles through me. But the fact of it is it doesn't need to be just one man or one woman moving in these things. The whole church is supposed to be moving in these things. But we've had a culture of you sitting there listening and watching and being, you know, just a spectator instead of being engaged. And of course, not around here, I'm not going to allow it.
Amen.
I'm just not going to allow it.
Amen.
If I see you doing something that's just zeal, I'm going to encourage your zeal. If I see you doing something that's stupid, I'm going to shut that down. If I see you doing something that's zeal and truth, I'm going to encourage that. We're going to go ahead and go with that. If I see strange fire, we're not going to allow it.
Amen.
Huh? And you got to trust me to help you with that. Because I'm purposed to see you go everywhere preaching the gospel. I'm purposed to see you go and take nations by the power of the Holy Ghost. So you're going to have to be taught right. And God's going to give us the capacity to help you learn and understand right. So we're going to get up in your face and we're going to correct you. And probably the first thing we're going to have to deal with is any pride and arrogance. And the stubbornness. It's usually the first layers. Before we can even start helping you, say, no, just understand, do this. Just do this. Understand it this way. Go ahead and give yourself to some more prayer and fasting. Hallelujah. Go ahead, I want you to learn how to become more passionate about your worship. I want you, maybe you have to just close your eyes. I don't have to close my eyes. And maybe you need to close your eyes and shut out the things that are around you. Hallelujah. We're going to help you this way. God, give us the knowledge and the understanding to help you this way. I can tell you everybody that I know that has ever done anything in the kingdom will tell you, you show me somebody who knows how to worship and I'll show you somebody who knows how to flow and operate in the gifts of the Spirit.
Amen.
And they're not talking about somebody who sings. They're talking about somebody who worships. Because you can have a voice that sounds like a caw crowing, a crow cawing, brother. And know how to worship. You know how to hook up with the Holy Ghost. God's looking for people who know how to worship. He's given us the ability to know how to worship.
Amen.
Who know how to be filled with the passion of His love and His joy. Be overwhelmed by holy emotions.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus. It's the greatest emotions and explosion of emotion that you can imagine. I've heard many preachers try to describe it in many different terms. This realm of heaven that explodes within our life, within our passions and emotions by the Holy Ghost. And all of them fall far too short. You're going to have to go ahead and investigate yourself. But all these things of heaven are available for you. For as by one, and then I want to go ahead and just, I don't want to get this, I don't want to read these verses of scripture yet, because I just want to go ahead and bring you down to verse 28 and let you just see. God has set some in the church. Look at this. What else has God placed in the church? We already just read a list of nine different demonstrations of the Holy Ghost that is supposed to be being expressed through each individual person in the church. He left nobody out. And now he's going to tell us what's also resident in the church. Once again, this is the overall general view that it's here, that we don't have to pray it down, that we don't have to try to hope that it's going to come. But if it's the church, then these things are in the church. And so in the church, he's placed apostles. He's also placed prophets there. He's also placed teachers there. And he's just enumerating them. It's not like, well, first there's going to be an apostle, and then there'll come a prophet. And then no, he's saying these are what's resident in the church. This is what's resident in the church. Hallelujah. And he says after that, he gave resident in the church miracles. Gifts of healing. There are mantles here right now. Pick it up. Tori, you picked it up. You're running with it. It's just saying it's yours. You're vested with authority. Just go do it. You don't have to look at yourself and say, am I good enough? Do I know enough? That's all nonsense. That's all heady knowledge. That's all your own salvation. You get vested with what God has given. It's a free gift. And now you know who you are. And any lack you have, he's taking up your slack and perfecting everything that's concerning you. You in him and he's in you. And you didn't earn it. It was a gift that came. Hallelujah. Just rejoice for a few minutes. It's a gift that came. It's yours. Now let me just say, I mean, that's just good news for everybody who's been longing for it. Because the prophets of old sought to have that, and it was revealed to them that they couldn't have it. And that they weren't talking or ministering to themselves. Look at that right there. That represents blood poured out at Calvary's cross that lives and abides forever. He entered into the holies of all, not made with hand, with his own blood, and redeemed everything. Hallelujah. Not only things in the earth, but things also in the heavens as well. And it never loses power. It's alive today, and it'll be there that day when we stand before him and we participate in the marriage supper. He said, I'll not drink it again until I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom. That's the marriage supper of the Lamb's going to be happening. Right, while all the tribulation stuff is going on down here, the marriage supper of the Lamb's going on up there. Hallelujah. Ha ha. And Jesus Christ takes for himself, sits us all down. He's able to get around to everybody. I don't know how it is, but I'm going to tell you, it's a miracle working power of God, and he's going to serve each one of us. And it's not going to be a few, because the company is an innumerable company dressed in white in Revelation chapter 7, who come out of great tribulation since the days of Abel. Since the days of Abel, there's been great tribulation. Hallelujah. The church has suffered great tribulation. Hallelujah. God wants to use you. It's never too late. Father wants to do great things through you. It's never too late. Abraham didn't even get called till he was 75. Huh? I mean, Joshua sowed into his ministry for 40 years, just captivated by the presence. Just that stayed in church 40 years. Now, that's what the scripture said. It didn't depart from the door of the tabernacle once the glory came down. He's captivated. I'm captivated. To step into one of the great ministries of all times, to command the sun and the moon with spirit knowledge, with the divine authority, because Moses imparted to him some of the honor and majesty and splendor that he was in his life. Huh? Do you hear that? Majesty, honor, and splendor. That's what that Hebrew word means there. Impart unto Joshua some of the majesty, honor, and splendor that I've given to you. Joshua, Yehoshua, did all that he did with a little bit of what Moses had. And you and I have received all of his fullness.
Amen.
And of his fullness have all we received. Did you read that? It came right after you read, as many as receive, he gave them the authority to be sons of God. Those who would believe on his name, because that name is above every name. That name is vested with all power and authority. And then it goes on to say, by the time, that was verse 12, verse 14, or is it 16? And of his fullness have all we received.
Amen.
Of his fullness.
Amen.
That's what John was talking about. Says, our eyes have seen and our hands have handled, and we've looked upon that eternal life. The life was manifested unto us, and we now reveal him to you. And Jesus has been ascended up on high now, by the time John said that, at least 30 years. And maybe a few more. Because John lived 60 years past the death of Jesus and resurrection. He was still alive by 90 AD. Jesus was crucified in 30 AD. April the 6th, 30 AD. John was still around in 90. And by traditional records, he was still around by 100 AD. And he was still revealing Jesus, the eternal life. Jesus. And I belong to that church. What church do you belong to? What church are you in? There's mantles, there's giftings, there's divine power and ability, there's spirit knowledge. The Father wants to fill you with. He wants to strengthen you with all power, with all strength according to His glorious power, so that you may have spiritual knowledge and understanding. Colossians 1:10 and 11. Let me try to finish here. It's too hard for me to finish. I have enough periods. Helps and governments and diversity of tongues. And of course, Paul goes on. People get all hooked up in the rhetorical questions of verse 29 and 30. And they forget about everything else that was spoken and read. It just is crazy to me. And, you know, and I could just start, go down here to all speak with tongues. No, but you all should.
Amen.
And he's making he's opening up a door of an opportunity. Because if you've got around Paul's ministry, look at how Paul ministers. Ephesians chapter 19, as soon as he sees some people, and this wasn't a unique situation, he sees some disciples in Ephesus. He says, first thing he says to them, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? Next thing he does is lay hands on them. They receive the Nambodo Sekiti Adanamabatai. And I know exactly where the Corinthian church learned all of their bad habits. They learned it from Paul. Hallelujah. He had to say, listen, the church service needs to be a little bit more than just everybody. I know it's great. And I know you're offering praise excellently. Hallelujah. But we got some people in here that don't know nothing. They don't even know that Jesus came. They don't even know who he is, and we need to tell them. They don't even know his name. But in the midst of all of this, he's describing something so important that is overlooked. What he's describing as he goes into this wonderful description of the fact that we are the very being of Jesus Christ, we're the very being of Jesus. Verse 12, he says, as I quoted this earlier, for as the body is one and hath many members, and all those members, I remember verse 13, for by one spirit are you all baptized into one body. I don't want to go into the description of him just breaking down each individual members and each individual part, trying to help everybody recognize, wait a minute, just like you have fingers that do something and toes that do something different and hands that do something and feet that do something different and eyes that do something and ears that do something different, doesn't make you different from that singular body, because that is just all a description of the one single body. And he's trying to help us understand that we are Christ. That we his body.
Amen.
And that we in him, and that we functioning by him. And it is the expressions of who he is and what he is doing and what he looks like. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. Come on now, people. And in the midst of all of this, being his person, being his being, him being right here with us as the head is always with the body. He's describing that this outworking of his anointing and his power that was seen when he walked the earth 1986 years ago is still being expressed through each individual by the same Holy Ghost, with the words of knowledge and the word of wisdom and the working of miracles and discerning of spirits and the gifts of faith and the gifts of healing, prophecy and tongues and interpretation of tongues, and all the function of that which ultimately the church is expressing simply on the basis of that's who Jesus Christ is, anointed with the Holy Ghost and power, who went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. And it's even greater than that, because now it's not just the earthly ministry, it's the heavenly ministry, all power and all authority.
Amen.
And then when we grab a hold of this communion, we start taking communion. We're describing our oneness with him. We can't be those who run the risk of not discerning the body of Christ, recognizing who he is and what he did for us. And when we take a hold of the body and we're saying, listen, this is the children's bread, and the children's bread is healing. We're taking a hold of the bread. We're taking a hold of the healing covenant. That's what the bread is. It's the bread of the covenant. this healing for God's people. It represents the Passover lamb that as they ate it that night, they woke up the next morning, you know, as it were. I'm sure that many of them didn't sleep. I probably would have dozed off. There was not one sick among them.
Amen.
And then we say, wait a minute. I understand divine health. People in the Pentecostal movement don't even understand divine health anymore. Praise God, I was around the Pentecostal movement as a child, and my dad was around the Pentecostal movement, and the Pentecostal movement has been in my family since Pentecost. So that I understand the teaching of divine health. And people look at you like, now, divine health. Yeah, you don't ever need to be sick. You don't ever have to get sick. Divine
Amen.
Health. Yeah, by his stripes we were healed.
Amen.
And say, by his stripes we're going to be healed. We were healed. It's the covenant. It's the covenant
Amen.
Bread.
Hallelujah.
And that's what Jesus said when he's talking about, this is my body, it's broken for you. And it's broken the stripes. It's broken for you. It's the healing bread. It's the healing covenant bread. It does nothing's changed from the Old Testament to the New Testament with response, with respect to the symbol. And when we talk about the blood of Jesus Christ, we understand this is the new covenant in my blood, which is given to you for the complete expunging, erasing, removing, eradicating of sin. And then people are going to come up and drink of the cup and still say, well, I'm just a sinner. What? Oh, well, Paul said it. I'm the chief of sinners. I don't even know what you're talking about. You're going to take one verse of scripture and overthrow and capitulate 1,000 because you don't even understand the verse of scripture and realize that there's one of three ways that can even be translated to start off with? Because
yeah.
I guarantee you, Paul did not view himself as a sinner.
Amen.
Viewed himself as, he said, I bear in my body the very life of Jesus. In my mortal flesh, Jesus Christ is revealed in me. It was revealed to him that God had purposed to reveal his son, Christ Jesus, in him. He conferred not with flesh and blood, but went into Arabia for 3 years. And after that, he went up to Damascus and then to Jerusalem. And God gave him an abundance of a revelation in the midst of all of that. And that, as a result, he wrote 2/3 of the New Testament, described to you how you and I have been born again, made a new creation, have righteousness and true holiness, belong to God. He's in us and we're in him.
Amen.
Tell me who's this. That is the most... That is the most demonic, evil deception that could be spoken and uttered.
Yeah.
Amen.
To call that which God has cleansed common and unclean.
Yeah.
This is the table of the Lord.
Yeah.
This is the redemption.
Amen.
This is the provision. His body and his blood, the new covenant. The New Testament representing the new birth that we're in him, he's in us, and then he's given to us his authority, his life, his glory. We belong to him. We bought with a price. We not our own. We're washed and cleansed in the blood. Faith in his body and in his blood. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Everybody on this side stand. I want you to come. Just hold on to this till we get to just have it together. Jesus said, he that eats my flesh and drinks my blood dwells in me and I in him. Hallelujah. I know Noam's doesn't really know what she's doing.
Okay.
But you can give her a little and just tell her to say, Jesus' body.
Okay.
I know she feels like she's totally left out, but that's all right, baby. This is communion, sweetheart. We're praying. This is prayer. It's Jesus' body. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Monday. In other words, you live by him. You're saying you live by him. He's in you. Get the lamb on the inside of you. Hallelujah. Sikada bandeshe prikajo. Hallelujah. Lord bless. Be blessed. Command you to be blessed. And I command you to be blessed. Are you a sinner or a saint? Okay, good, good. Santos?
Santa.
Santas. Okay, very good.
Santa.
Very good. How many people in here tonight, you holy?
Yes.
If you're not holy, you have no right to eat at this table.
Yes.
How many people in here tonight, you righteous?
Yes.
If you're not righteous, you have no right to eat at this table.
Yes.
Because this table brought to us his righteousness and his holiness.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Karasananeya. Be blessed in Jesus' name. Command you to be blessed in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Mongazadeya. Thank you, Jesus. Love you. Love you, David. Hamaze taste kist. Hamalea patanayo. Jesus, we love you. Jesus, we love you. Jesus. I just pray that you consider tonight all that Jesus went through to provide for you this so great a salvation so you won't take it for granted another day. Amen. You recognize that he didn't just do a half a job. Well, one third of the job and left two thirds for you. You hear some people say it, that's what it is. Oh, he got my spirit, but now I got to take care of my soul and my body. He did it all, praise God. He did it all. Say, he did it all. What's this? What's that represent? That red body of Christ, that's right. Amen. Hallelujah. You're getting baptized next Sunday, aren't you, buddy? Praise God. Amen. He knows what's going on over here. How are you doing, Lucas?
Good.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. How are you doing tonight?
Good.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Be blessed. Father, thank you for your broken body. How are you doing, Lakota?
Ready to accept.
Good. Amen. So we're going to get you baptized on Sunday?
Yes, sir.
That is awesome. Yeah. Praise God. Yeah. Hallelujah. That is awesome, Lakota. I can see that in you, man. I see truth and sincerity. See, a person doesn't have guile on the inside of them. Sitting around trying to figure it all out. Be blessed. Be blessed. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. He's amazing. He did it all, Bruce. Look what he did, Bruce. All by him. Thank you. This section, come. Be blessed. Be blessed. Father, I thank you for the anointing right now in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for the anointing right now in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for the great manifestation of your presence and your power. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for Raphael. Hallelujah. Mighty man of God, Zoe. The lightnings of God, Clara. Thank you, Lord, for the anointing. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Sabro Kasananea. Love you too very much. If you gong leshti, halamai. If there's anybody that you don't love, you start loving them right now. Hey, mashe karoma. Oh, for God so loved the world. Hallelujah. Sutoranea pekela and Jesse Lee Kayakanokishi. Orandes to Keely Munch. Jack, are you saved?
Yes, I am.
Good, very good. There was a time I asked Jack if he was saved, and he'd go, well, I'm not sure. It took Jack for a long time to understand that he was, that the Lord loved him that much. And just so good. I'm looking forward to seeing Jack in his eternal body. As his life is set free, be blessed. And as he steps into the unlimited, be blessed. Goodness of God. And I'm looking for the same for you. Be blessed. Be blessed. Be blessed. I'm so glad the Lord worked it out that you're around here. He's gonna do what he wants to do anyway, ain't he? He's gonna get his way. Hallelujah. When there's any kind of truth on the inside, Papa gonna get his way. Daniel is moving. And he's still here. Turned all around, he's here. And we're glad of it. Hey, how are you doing? Do you know what this is? Huh? It's not a tortilla. You failed. You failed. Okay, you're going to have to spend, I want you to spend some more time with these guys, will you? I want you to spend some more time with them. Okay, are these guys, are you, you got this? Have you asked Jesus to come into your heart, into your life? Look at me up here. Have you asked Jesus to come into your heart, into your life? You have? That's good. This represents Jesus' body. This is not a tortilla. It's changed tonight. Work with them some more, okay? It's okay. There's no guile here, so you know, just kids. But we want them to know. We don't want them just having refreshments. Tortilla and juice. Work with them a little more there, buddy. Be blessed. How are you doing tonight? Whose father are you? Do these little guys know what this? Do these little guys know what this is? You told them. Okay. Well, what we're gonna do is I'm gonna have you do this. I'm gonna have you take this with the little guys, okay? And you're gonna divide it among them, and you're gonna talk to them about it, okay? In the way that only mom can talk to them. You're gonna go back to your chair and talk to them about it, okay? And then just take two of these, okay? And just kind of, okay? Why? Because I don't want it to become juice time. It can't be refreshment time. You got enough. I've got to make sure. You, stay right here. Mom's going to tell little brothers. She's going to help them. This is sacred. And if you don't start it at a young age, it gets all messed up at the very beginning. 70 years ago in the church, you could not have communion until you were examined. And there was a testimony and a more than two or three witnesses that you had the fruits of being born again. True. It's all changed. Not for me. Huh? Father, thank you so much for this amazing life. We love you so much. We love you. Faith, how are you doing, dear? You've already passed the exam. Bless you, JJ. We love you so much. Bless you, man. Thank you, Jesus. Ojek namaste koramo sefan. Be blessed. Jemasi. Go ahead, sweetie. Grab one of them. Hey, how are you there? She's looking around. Where's mine? It's not refreshment time, baby. Give you just a little bit more time on that one. Everybody would just stand, come up here with me, please. All you guys, did you everybody get communion? Get communion. What's your problem? You should run to the table. You won't be left out. You don't want to be left out. Ha! It's help yourself communion? They started throwing it back in the basket. Go ahead. Just interesting. I was just getting ready to tell Elizabeth to serve you communion, but that's okay. Run to the table from now on, okay? Just run to the table. You don't have to have somebody tell you, listen, the trumpet just sounded, you should go to heaven. Yeah. Just hand me a piece of bread, let me give it to you. Let me break it. Tori. Anybody else back there? Everybody got communion now? You done? Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You know, I think about the first moment in time this was represented and presented in great conquest and victory by Melchizedek. When Abraham returned from the slaughter of the kings. Amen. The testimony that God himself would become flesh. That the eternal God would take upon himself the garments of sinful flesh to become our servant, to offer his body as a sacrifice so that we may be made holy and acceptable unto God. And we're going to eat the sacrifice here today.
Amen.
The sacrifice of Christ Jesus. We're going to partake of that which represents all that he's done for us, to eat this bread. Yes. Jesus said, I am, Moses gave you not the true bread. I am the bread of life. This bread of life, this salvation, this sacrifice at Calvary, this bread that then became more than just a body offered it on a tree, but one that was raised up from the dead eternally.
Hallelujah.
So that as eternal God, having received the glory that he had with the Father from the very beginning, before ever the world was created, now he's raised up eternally with a human resurrected body, with scars in his hand, the nail-pierced scars in his hand. He stands before the throne of God as a lamb that is slain, with his pierced side, eternally, this offering. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The one who now forever lives to make intercession for us.
Amen.
The one who keeps us by his power. The one who both authored our salvation and finishes it too. It's amazing. There's no leaven in this bread. There's no sin in it. There's no transgression in it. It's his perfect sacrifice. You know, tonight we're getting ready to, this is a symbol that we recognize that he's in us. He's in me. I want you to understand the communion is, this is the fellowship. This is our communion with the Father. He's in me. It's Christ Jesus. It's the greater one on the inside of me that allows me to wage war from the place of victory. Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Tonight, if there's any sickness in your body, be healed right now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you for the bread. Thank you for the bread. Thank you for your life, your body, Lord Jesus. Lord, we thank you that you bore our sins in your own body on the tree. Thank you for the sacrifice. Thank you, O God, that you were willing to be slaughtered for me, that I might now eat the bread of fellowship and the bread of communion. See, it's not the sin offering, really. Because you're not allowed to eat the sin offering. Sin offering must be burned with fire outside the camp. This is the peace offering.
Amen.
This is the Passover offering.
Hallelujah.
This is the one that you could just sit down and eat.
Hallelujah.
Fellowship. Hallelujah. He's our Passover. Hallelujah. Ooh, la, ba, ba, sa, hallelujah. It is a communion. Hallelujah. It's peace to those. It's peace to those who are far away and peace to those that are near. A oneness kind of relationship. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. He said, "This is my body which is given for you. Eat it in remembrance of me." And after that they had supped, he also took the cup. And he said, "This is the blood of the new covenant. This is the new covenant in my blood, which is given to you for the complete removal, remission, erasing, deleting." I mean, really deleting. I mean, there's no memory of it on the hard drive. Completely deleting. "To remove our sins as far as the east is from the west, that they be remembered in one." I tell you right now, if the accuser comes reminding you of your sin, just begin to worship the Lord, because as in his presence, you can't remember that you ever did anything wrong. There's no remembrance of sin. There's none. Just get lost over in the anointing. You don't even remember nothing, never done anything wrong. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woo! Woo! Makes me feel like dancing. I'm telling you right now, that's a matured praise. That's better than any song you've ever heard written by the most famous person. That's worship that comes right out of the realms of the depths of the Holy Ghost. Ha! Ah. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for the cup of rejoicing. Hallelujah. There are three times that you're supposed to appear before the Lord, and every time, the three times out of the year, one of them being Passover, you're supposed to present yourself before the Lord with joy and rejoicing. Yeah. Not sorrow and sadness. Yeah. And this is the cup of rejoicing. Yeah. Hallelujah. 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 Only at the abiding place. Thank you, Lord Jesus. That's so sweet. No alcohol in that.
Amen.
No bitterness, no leaven.
Amen.
Just sweet juice. Yes. Just sweet redemption.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Almighty God, thank you so much. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for a sacrifice of praise that is well pleasing in your sight. Lay man, find a bunch of people around you right now. Hug them. Tell them that you love them. Bless them in Jesus' name. Jesus. Lord Jesus. Torrama mambando de deshi ki dambla bebes. Sutada da bebe vekar mosata la dana na main in the shikar de pridai. So many sita ul. So many nande rusila. Mamma mandari. Thank you, Father, for your love and kindness. Thank you, Father, for your tender mercies. The blood is the power to deal with every condemnation, the power to deal with every shame and guilt. The blood is the power to deal with every offense of sickness and disease and sin. The washing, the cleansing. Oh, your glory, Lord. Your glory, Lord. Your glory, oh God. Your glory, oh God, now made manifest in the midst of your church like never before, oh God, we pray. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Your signs, your wonders, your miracles. Your gifts of healing and faith. Mama na 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 na. Mambre mama na njero, mama nkere, mama na na. Na na nothing but the blood of Jesus. Lord, we thank you that you sprinkled clean water upon us and that you cleansed us, that you gave us a new heart, a new spirit, and that you put your spirit within us. Mambando seri mengai la manavalala. Birisham balin in the kiri no mandora. Zera mamando si prima mandalin and beri mamalin in the kiri sofre. Jesus. Everybody, worship the Lord with your tithes and with your offerings. Just worship Him. Just keep hugging each other and loving each other, but also just worship the Lord. If there's anybody who's sick in this place, we want. If there's a possibility that you're still sick, we want to break that thing off of you in the name of Jesus. We don't want anybody going out of here with any kind of pain in Jesus' name. Rather, you walk in the authority of the living God. You in charge. God placed you in charge. You in charge. Hallelujah. 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 Let me tell you something, as you're listening to me. You know, Father, he designed family, and he designed company. He designed family and kindred and tongues and nations. And the beautiful thing about it is, we're going to be doing this together for all eternity. It's just going to be in greater expressions of His divine power and His glory. Because when we gathered unto Him, we are gathered by families and by companies. By family, by kindred, and by company, tongues, and by nations. Yes, we are. You're going to be around all of your loved ones and all of your family that has gone into glory, that has gone into heaven, and around all the company of people that have you carried on a relationship with in the Spirit. And all those that were brought into the kingdom because of your testimony. and all those also that you're connected with, because through their faith and testimony, you were brought into the kingdom. I'm telling you right now, get ready, because you're heading into a very good place that you don't want to miss out on. And whatever battle you got to fight to get there, you get to fight from the place of victory. So get her done. Whatever thing you, whatever it is that you need to deny, get to denying it. Whatever thing that you need to stop allowing, get to stopping. Because it's just too good to miss out on. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Now, once again, worship the Lord with your tithes and offerings. And I want to pray for everybody who needs prayer. Anybody needs prayer, sick, diseased in your body, whatever it is that you have need of, just come. And we're going to pray with you, for you. The Lord's going to touch you. Hallelujah.